Well, good morning. Welcome to Park Road Baptist Church. Wow, I'm sorry you aren't here. Excuse me. I'm sorry that you aren't here to hear that. Mom and Dad have enjoyed having been at home for a few weeks. That's been one of the silver linings for a lot of parents to have their college-age kids home. We've enjoyed having Bennett with us, and we're so grateful this morning for the music that he and Mark Fry will provide. Sorry that you're not here. Mark has already said that when we are able to come back together, we're going to have a concert of all of this music that you have missed so you can hear it in person. But thank you to Bennett Dean and Mark Fry for this morning. I just want to thank you as we begin. I want to thank you for being the church. You have been, you continue to be the church. Thank you in so many ways. Every time you reach out to a friend and make a phone call, every time you join into a Zoom meeting, every time you reach out to one of your neighbors in this congregation, you are the church. Thank you for being so, for supporting this congregation, for allowing us to continue our missions and ministries in this difficult time. So thank you for being the church. Our ministry council, I will remind you, has met and said we will continue to follow North Carolina guidelines along with many other churches in the city. We will continue to meet in this way until at least the beginning of phase three, and then we will make other plans for finding a way to safely return. But thank you for being the church together. We continue our midweek meetups on and on every Wednesday night at 6 o'clock. We will meet. Amy and I have really enjoyed that short, simple time, just a casual time to share some stories. She and I have been making some door prizes. I've been back in the wood shop. She has been back in the kitchen. We'll have another little door prize to give away on Wednesday night. Would love to have you to join us. A lot of fun, Wednesday night at 6 o'clock. Continue to stay posted with the newsletter and our videos and messages to know what all is going on with the church. But thank you, Park Road, for being such a strong community for so many folks in this difficult time. We're glad to have you in worship today. We will begin with another litany as we have done so each week. I'll give you your line. There's a beautiful hymn that we sing that says, God grant us light that we may see. Amy will be talking some today about what we can see, what we're able to see. And so your line is, God grant us light that we may see. I'll point to you. God grant us light that we may see. On dark days of disease and disaster, on long days of anxiety and aloneness, on bright days of comfort and convenience, Jesus came as Emmanuel, God with us, to teach us that no matter the circumstance, whatever our need each day, God is our daily bread, just what we need for each day. But Jesus said, faith is for those who have eyes to see. So this day, may God grant us the faith of Jesus. God grant us light that we may see. Let us pray together. God, grant us light that we may see. On difficult days, grant us light that we may see your goodness with us in so many ways, with the communion that comes from friends, phone calls, cards, messages, simple contacts of kindness. God, grant us light that we may see. And on better days, God, grant us light that we may see those struggling around us, that in that time we might reach out, that we might be your hands and feet, that we might be your light to them. So on dark days and on bright days, grant us light that we might see what you need us to see in that day, that we might be strengthened, that we might be your people, that we might know your goodness in this place. Thank you for a time to worship, an opportunity to worship, the technology that allows us to be together. So be with us in these moments, scattered as we are, that we might be one in spirit. And hear us now as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our hymn is Rejoice Ye Pure in Heart. We're going to sing three verses this morning because it's a short hymn. We encourage you to sing. We've enjoyed hearing you say that you've enjoyed singing with us. And so Mark will play an introduction and we'll sing three verses. Rejoice, you pure in heart. Thank you for your beautiful singing. We could almost enjoy it from here. I want to talk to our children now for just a few moments. Boys and girls, I want to talk to you about what you can see, what you do see when you go outside. This is a beautiful, beautiful time of the year. Each morning, I've been getting up and going out on our back patio and sitting and enjoying watching nature just spring forth around us. All of the beautiful colors. And one thing I've enjoyed in our backyard, we have a large bird feeder, and we've been keeping it stocked with food, and birds coming and enjoying that feed, that food from the bird feeder. But, you know, I can't identify different birds. I don't know whether you can. You know, I can tell the robin redbreast and a redbird. We have beautiful cardinals that come and some bluebirds. That's about all I can tell. The bluebirds, the cardinal, the robin. But, you know, there are thousands of different birds. And if you learn to pay attention, you can learn to identify them. You may know Mr. Alan Eakes. And you may know that Alan is a birder. Since he was a child, Alan has been watching birds and identifying birds and learning to recognize them by what they look like. And every time Alan sees a new bird, he has a notebook. And he writes it down, what bird he saw, and he identifies it by specific species, and he writes the date down. Alan's been doing this for his whole life, and Alan has identified almost 700 species of birds. I didn't even know there were that many different kinds of birds. You know, there's the robin, and there's the cardinal, and there's the bluebird in my backyard. Alan has seen 700 different kinds of birds. Not too long ago, we were over at the lake where my family likes to spend some time together. Amy and I were over there. There's a huge nest in a tree on the way, and I took a picture of it, and I said, Alan, is this an eagle? And he wrote me back immediately and said, no, that's an osprey's nest. It's not an eagle. Alan could tell just from looking at the nest And there was another place down on the lake that there was another big nest. And so I took a picture of that, and I sent it to him. And I said, Alan, I'm guessing this is an osprey also. And he wrote back and said, no, that's a bald eagle's nest there. Alan can identify birds because he pays attention. I want to know what you're paying attention to. What do you see when you go outside? Do you recognize things? You know, we learn to see what we want to see, what we train our eyes to see. And Amy's going to talk some about what we are seeing these days. I want you to think about what it is that you see, what you can see when you go outside. And maybe like Mr. Alan Eakes, you'll learn to identify birds and enjoy that part of God's beautiful creation. What can you see? Let's pray together. Thank you, God, for the beauty of all creation that you have made. We're grateful this day for all of that beauty. Open our eyes that we might see. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
There's a lot about a Facebook Live worship experience that just doesn't feel normal. It doesn't feel normal to us, and I know it doesn't feel normal to you either. On this end, speaking to a computer screen in a nearly empty sanctuary just doesn't feel like church. And mostly, we miss seeing you here. All the while, understanding that this is necessary for the time being. As the person who often leads our time of confession, what feels awkward to me at times is our moment of silence that follows this introduction to our prayer time. As powerful as observing that quiet moment is when we worship together in person, it sometimes feels sort of artificial to me when we're physically separated from one another. And I confess that I can't help wondering if you might be using this minute to run to the kitchen or to check the news on your phones. But even during the pandemic, and perhaps especially during the pandemic, quiet moments of reflection are important. And I believe there's power in us observing this moment of silent prayer together, even when we're physically separated. So would you join me now in a moment of silence? And now let us pray together. Our loving and gracious God, we fill our lives with noise and confusion, and we rarely make space for the silence of prayer. We'd rather not stop to examine our choices too closely or to take responsibility for all of our actions. And yet we are reminded that often it's in quiet moments that you speak to us, and in silence that we are met by your grace. You breathe life into each of us each day. You welcome us just as we are, with all our hopes and fears, all our faults and talents. May we learn to rest in your spirit, and may we remember that you alone renew our lives. Forgive us, God, when we stray from your ways, when we hurt one another, when we ignore the needs of others, when we resist your guidance in our lives. Help us shake off all that weighs us down, that we may be free to hold fast to you, the one who fills our lives with unmerited grace and abounding love. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. As you search for times of silence during these days, please remember that you are loved and you are forgiven. So be at peace.
On the cultural calendar, we're in the midst of Memorial Day weekend. On the liturgical calendar, it's really Ascension Sunday, the day that the disciples described the last day that they were aware of the presence of Jesus in their midst in what seemed like more tangible ways. But we've come to see this Memorial Day holiday as a kickoff to summer, that one last day off to push to the end of school and the beginning of summer, where we give a little lip service this weekend in thanks for our freedoms, including our freedom to worship. And isn't it wonderful that we have continued to worship and serve and study and pray and confess and praise? No one and no pandemic can stop the love of God and the way of Jesus, even if we alter the ways in which we commit our lives to these premises. The church is who we are as a people, a community of faith seeking to live out God's call on our lives individually and collectively, even when we alter the ways in which we do this in order to protect each other, to love each other, to honor each other, and to value each other. Friends, let us be bold in these days. Let us be committed in these days. Let us be courageous in these days. And let us be compassionate and loving in these days. We should not take this freedom to worship lightly. On this weekend, of all weekends, we recall the sacrifice of life and service that grants us this very freedom. But let us also be very clear. The church has not been closed all this time. The church, and this particular church, has been open in altered ways, yes, but we are alive and well and thriving. We have felt very connected to you in these days. We have felt as if we have been in sync with you in these days. We have sensed a vibrancy of the Spirit of God among us in these days, even as we long to return to something that feels more normal. We are open. We are at work in ministry and mission. We are present. We are together. We are showing up. We are serving. We are alive and well and thriving. Make no mistake, we are functioning in very different ways in order to stay safe and protect especially the most vulnerable among us. And we do this precisely because we follow Jesus. It is a blessed freedom that we get this opportunity. Let us not squander it. So welcome to Park Road Baptist Church. We are so glad to have you worshiping with us today. We were never called to be televangelists. I'm sure you can tell that by now. And we are not set up to be a very techie church. But we modify and we adapt because we give thanks for the freedom to worship God who loves us unconditionally. And we give thanks for the freedom to follow the one that calls us to walk in the way of justice and mercy. We have not closed. We will not close. We continue to be the church. Thanks be to God. And welcome to Park Road Baptist Church. It may be Memorial Day weekend on the calendar that the country keeps, but on the church's liturgical calendar, it's Ascension Sunday. It's that crazy scene where Jesus is taken up into heaven right before their very eyes. It's told from several perspectives, but today we're going to look at it by the way that it's told in the Acts of the Apostles, beginning with Acts chapter 1. I'm going to read in just a second, starting with verse 6. Acts 1, starting with 6. It's that crazy scene. Keep in mind, it's a colorful story. It's fantastical, even. Don't get lost in the glitz and glamour. Stay rooted in what's being told and set it in its context. The Jesus they'd already lost once, and then they found risen from the dead, is now gone again. And you're going to catch them standing there just like this. While he was with them, he always had an answer. He always had a plan. They usually didn't understand it, but it's comforting to know that somebody in the group knows what's going on. So we're about to read that he's gone again. And they look after him where they saw him last. So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, is this the time you will restore the kingdom to Israel?" And he replied, "It's not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." He turned it on them. You. When he said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up. Told you it was glitz and glamour. He was lifted up and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while he was going and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them and they said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus who has been taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." So what did they do? Did they continue to stand there just gazing up? No. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. And when they had entered the city, they went up to the room upstairs where they were staying, Peter, John, James, Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James, Simon, and Judas. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer, together with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers. You've heard the ancient story. Let us listen now for the word of the Lord. There's a ton to be unpacked here, but in a global pandemic, there are several things I believe are true. Number one, I think during a global pandemic, we should not have tornadoes and microbursts and days and days and days of rain. Number two, I think that during a global pandemic, we should never hear the words murder hornets. And number three, I think during a global pandemic, we should only unpack one thing at a time when it comes to theological understandings of complicated texts. Most of us are functioning with a good bit of anxiety, so let's only try and bite off what we can actually chew. And in this most unbelievable scene that needs about 10 sermons and a lot of discussion and a lot of back and forth, I'm going to give you one thing that caught my attention. Because in a global pandemic, that's about all we can take. Jesus ascends. And suddenly, two men in white robes stood by the disciples, and they said, as those guys are just standing there, mouths agape, staring up into heaven, they said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven?" Now, I have to stop just a second and tell you that laughter saves my life. I love to laugh, and I love to make people laugh. So I will confess, I have become an avid follower of an actor that has become an Instagram sensation during this pandemic. His name is Leslie Jordan. And I warn you, he can be crass and inappropriate. Jamie clearly listens to Leslie Jordan also because she is already laughing. And I know that some of you are out there saying, I love him too. He can be crass and inappropriate, but he does make me laugh. I love his stories about his family and his growing up and lessons he learned from his mama. I love his accent. I love the way he laughs at himself. So as I scroll through my news feed, when he pops up, I have to listen. And I always laugh. He begins most of his very brief videos by saying, well, what are y'all doing? Now, he typically adds an expletive, so if that offends, then I don't recommend him to you. He has a shirt that goes with his leading sentence that contains the crass word, and he's raising money for food with that. Good for him for doing something good with that. But when I read this text from Acts and saw that there were two men in white robes that appeared to the disciples as they were standing there trying to take in the fact that Jesus wasn't really with them the way they needed for him to be, and they asked, what are you doing here looking up toward heaven? All I could hear was Leslie Jordan saying, well, what are y'all doing? Now, you're going to go look it up, and you're going to have to watch about 10 of these to finally kind of get in the groove. And again, I warn you, if you don't like bad words, just don't look at it. I think we can safely assume some things here in this text as we keep that image of, in our mind. Well, what are y'all doing? It is highly likely that the disciples were perplexed, confused, bewildered, befuddled, baffled, anxious, nervous, apprehensive, not knowing what to do and where to turn, alone, incensed, afraid, frustrated, left behind, terrified, not knowing what to do next. And in the middle of all these things, they get the question, well, what are y'all doing? So I think this ascension scene shows up right on time in this global pandemic, because folks are feeling perplexed, confused, bewildered, befuddled, baffled, anxious, nervous, apprehensive, not knowing what to do or where to turn, alone, incensed, afraid, frustrated, left behind, terrified, not knowing what to do next. It's like we are globally standing in this scene, just looking up and feeling so hopeless and helpless and not knowing what to do, mouths agape, just standing here waiting. And so on behalf of the guys in white robes, I ask you, well, what are y'all doing? Perhaps a better way to ask the question is, how do we spend our time when we are feeling all of these things? There's no one right way to be spending your time. There's no one right way to manage your anxiety. There's no one right way to respond to the altered lives we are all having to lead. But the question should make us ponder, how attentive are we being? Are we just standing here looking up and doing nothing? Or are we willing to see the presence of God all around us and within us that calls us to a fullness of life, even in the midst of being perplexed, confused, bewildered, befuddled, battled, anxious, nervous, apprehensive, not knowing what to do or where to turn, alone, incensed, afraid, frustrated, left behind, terrified, and not knowing what to do next? How attentive are you being to the presence of God all around us and within us that calls us to a fullness of life even when we are most distraught? The text says that after pondering this question from the men in white robes, the disciples returned to Jerusalem and hunkered down in an upper room, joined by Mary and the other women and they prayed. Maybe that's what you're doing, hunkered down, praying. Maybe you're handling the stress by learning something new or cleaning out a closet. Maybe you're handling the stress by knocking out a wall and planting flowers. Maybe you're handling stress by cooking or listening to music or donating skills or money to help those in need. Maybe you handle stress by talking it out. And maybe you handle stress by running or doing yoga. Maybe you handle stress by journaling. Maybe you handle stress by escaping in a good book or watching a movie. Maybe you need to cry more. Maybe you need to laugh more. And maybe you need to do more of both. But what you can't do is nothing. Just standing there paralyzed and immobilized to make a move, any move toward health and life and wholeness and healing. In my imagination, the question posed to these disciples was a small push toward returning to life without Jesus in their very midst. And when they came to learn as they made, and what they came to learn as they made their way back to life was that he was very much still with them as they remembered his teachings and told his stories and recounted all the times that he set people free from all that kept them bound. There's one more thing from this passage. This Jesus will come again in the same way you saw him go, they said. It's easy to picture that being a great descending from the sky with everyone just standing around waiting for that grand and glorious day, doing nothing, just standing there waiting. But something I read about this text helped me to picture this in a much less literal way, and it made so much more sense. Those disciples realized that they would see Jesus again just the way he was, he is. They would see him every time they fed the poor and clothed the naked and visited the sick, because Jesus remains among us in all of the people we are helping to find healing. Jesus remains among us in all of the people that we are able to set free from all that keeps them bound. We do not wait for Jesus to return. He is already here in the most vulnerable among us. And sometimes we are him. We do not wait for Jesus to return. So let us not be caught just standing there looking up, waiting and watching and doing nothing to make the world a better place, doing nothing to bring hope and healing, doing nothing to bring life and resurrection good news. Well, what are y'all doing? May it be so. Amen.
Be where your feet are. Back in January, as a new staff member, I was part of a youth ministry retreat where Amy was the proclaimer for the week. She challenged us with those words, be where your feet are. She offered these words not in a sense of being stuck and unable to move, rather to be present and take it all in, to notice and to feel all of life. At that point, youth ministry plans here at Park Road were well into their planning stages. Spring retreat, summer mission trip, university, and so much more. I sort of took Amy's words lightly in those moments, not knowing how valuable those words would be in the coming months, when all any of us could and can do is to be where our feet are with so many unknowns every day. Will you pray with me? Creator God, you gave us feet to walk, to balance, feet to be stable and grounded, feet to play in dirt or walk in grass barefoot. Will you help us be still enough to be where our feet are and pay attention? You gave us feet to walk through the terrible seasons of life, when pain is so near, feet to stand back up when the going feels like too much? Will you help us to be still enough to be where our feet are, to pay attention? You gave us feet to celebrate beauty and goodness when we can't stop our feet from dancing and jumping, feet strong and competent to breathe and take it all in. Will you help us be still enough to be where our feet are, to pay attention? You gave us feet to be helpers and truth seekers, feet to walk beside every person we encounter with great intention and purpose, feet full of justice and advocacy, feet to help others trust the strength of their own feet. Will you help us be still enough to be where our feet are, to pay attention? And God, when the time comes to walk away, fill our feet with courage and hope for a better day. And gracious God, we know your spirit is with us through it all. We ask for your spirit to be made known through other people willing to stand with us, sit with us, and walk with us throughout the entire journey. Amen.
Thank you.
So Amy asked, what are y'all doing? And the musicians play, Here I Am, Lord. Beautiful response. Thank you. I want to thank you again for the way you have responded. That's our offertory. Thank you for the way you are responding, that we may continue to be the church in this place in these difficult days. Many churches are not having this response. We're so, so grateful to you, and we will continue to be the church in every way we can during these difficult times. Thank you for being found faithful.
Following the benediction, we hope you'll stay on for one more piece of music before we close this worship service today. We close this time of worship. The church remains very open. Please, please don't forget that. The final word is not ours, but the Lord's. So hear this good word of benediction as we go.
May the Lord bless you and keep you.
May God's face shine upon you, and may God be gracious to you.
May God give you grace this day to love with all your heart.
That you might do justice.
To love with all your soul.
That you might show mercy.
To love with all your mind.
That you might walk humbly with your God.
As you go into the world this day, dear friends, love the Lord your God with all your strength.
And love your neighbor as yourself.
Thank you.